hematology and blood transfusion. So he will be talking about voluntary blood donation during this COVID-19 pandemic. So Dr. Sucheth, I request you to please start your presentation.
Thank you, ma'am. It's an honor, and it was a all we learned at this institute helped us tide through the pandemic. May I request Dr. Usha Shri to, okay, you have allowed me to share. I'll just take a second, ma'am. Am I visible now? Dr. Usha?
Yes, sir, it is visible, sir.
Yes, sir. PowerPoint is visible, sir. You can turn on your video also, sir, so that we can see you while you speak.
Okay, you want me to turn on the video. Okay. Is it okay now? Very good. Thank you.
Screen as well as see you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, and a very good morning to Professor Neelam Marwa, Professor R.R. Sharma, and all the other dignitaries. And welcome to the audience. I am Sucheth from PGI Chandigarh, and I've been deputed to look after the voluntary blood donations. Almost it's a decade now that this beautiful institute has taught us a lot. And I would be speaking on managing blood donations during the COVID pandemic. Now, this was a sudden and abrupt pandemic, and most of us were caught unawares. And there were advisories from government to refrain from moving, rather even touching your own face. And there was so much infodemic that a normal person's articulate capacity to take any decision was slightly disturbed. That is what basically translated into a lack of decision whether one should go to donate blood or not. So I will just tell you the statistics of our department at this premier institute in Northern India. And annually, we collect 60,000 blood units, and a majority of that, about 85%, is from voluntary source, because the seeds of voluntary blood donation, amongst other places in India, were also sown in this region by late Professor Jay Gopal Jolly. And we do around 400 outdoor blood donation drives. And from this 60,000, we produce and supply around 1.5 to 2 lakhs of blood components. And this is the trend of the voluntary blood donation drives or camps over the last two decades. And we almost have 400 outdoor exertion camps. This is the blood collection at our institute, which is almost 58 to 60,000. It has settled down around this in the last two decades. There has been contribution by many people to make it reach this place. This is the graph showing voluntary. The green is the voluntary blood donation, and the red is the family replacement donations. And you can appreciate that the green is almost growing, and it is settled around 85% of voluntary blood donation. Now, this pandemic, though it struck all of a sudden, but there were news starting late of January, and if people who had experience in planning of voluntary blood donations, could actually think, since when you plan next year's charter of blood donation, you often take into account many things like seasonal variations, seasonal shortages in view of festivities like Deepavali or Holi, when there is closure of colleges in the summers, and in times of dengue epidemics, that has taught us to some extent that we need to change our planning or put thrust on voluntary blood donation, do more camps, triage our usage of blood bags so that you can produce the optimum components. And that the key challenges were to the transfusion services. And there were some very good national initiatives by the National Blood Transfusion Council in terms of guidelines. And we actively managed at our center that I will be detailing next. I'll just take a second. The cursor is not allowing me to go further. Usha, could you help with this? Or may I stop sharing and go back again?
Yes, sir. I think we can do that, sir.
I think I'll have to go back. Just give me a second. It is not allowing to move ahead. Okay, it has started. So there was news of blood shortage everywhere, and all media was flooded with news that blood banks would run dry. The pandemic has hit the blood donation drive, and there was news all around that this is going to be a difficult time. However, the transfusion fraternity was, as per the past experience, the early messages from the American Association of Blood Banking that Americans are urged to donate blood to maintain continued adequacy of blood supply as coronavirus outbreak continues. So such messages as early as 4th of the March helped us show this to our local administration and then plan things accordingly. Even the PAHO warned of potential blood shortages, and there were Mayo Clinic has also written, and these were the challenges. There was a general scare amongst the public. Orders were from law enforcement agencies to avoid large crowds and lockdowns. Therefore, you could not hold outdoor blood donation camps. People may become ineligible for blood donation due to illness was a very big fear. There was no clarity on what testing would be instituted, though from previous experience, it was amply clear that these kind of respiratory infections do not transmit per se through blood donation or blood transfusion. And there were no guidelines when the pandemic struck as to what you should do to accept safe donors and what is the period for deferral. Sooner they came, and there was an acute shortage, and it was anticipated that up to 50% would be the shortage, and staff training and staff motivation was another challenge side by side apart from the logistics. So there was trouble in terms of safety and adequacy of blood, the environment of safety of the environment, both for the staff and the donors. There were issues with regard to staff training. There were regulatory issues which you could not go against and hold blood donation camps. And there were certain guidance from administrative and local level for holding lockdowns. Section 144 was imposed at times. There were curfews put up. So there was a real challenge, and the blood supply was severely hit. As all the community channels were blocked due to lockdown announced in the last week of March. Now, what to do about the patients who require perennial blood demand, like thalassemics, other medical and surgical emergencies, or the hemat-onc or the gynae and obstetric patients? So we initiated some measures. We were discussing this at around mid of the February, and there were some measures taken in the institute. There was an urgent hospital transfusion committee meeting convened, and we had a meeting of our faculty. And outside the institute, there was sensitization of the local administration with regard to the implications of COVID on blood supply. There was a massive IEC campaign conducted through first print media and then using all information technology. And there were efforts to reach out to both the local administration as well as the National Blood Transfusion Council for some guidelines. So this was what we started as early as the first week of March, and we did a very extensive IEC campaign through print media. We went and sought appointment from the Honorable Governor of Punjab and the Administrator of UT Chandigarh. And he was very kind. He gave us a very patient listening and could understand that there would be a second crisis in the event blood was not available. And you see, we met him in the first week. Then we wrote to him and he was so kind, and the orders were out by the 19th of March with regard to voluntary blood donation, that it should be continued for all the blood banks in Chandigarh. Sooner, there was a letter written to the director of the Blood Transfusion Council, and advisory from there was also very swift. There was a very proactive and very clear guideline, so we could start working within our institute. We communicated with all the heads of the clinical specialties, and before the lockdown, all the elective surgeries were, the blood which was collected were postponed. So that was a buffer stock which was available with us to work. We did 2 to 3 camps in a day, and that beautiful vehicle Blood Mobile was rotated for 4 hours twice a day at different locations to have enough blood collection. And then we requested our faculty, residents, and other staff of PGI. And there is a lot of cadre of staff which donates blood, and they all came forward to help us during the time. So we streamlined various processes and procedures, how to go about blood donation camps, what would be the disinfection profile. So all our blood donation center was fumigated, fogging was done using DESNET with those fogging machines every day after the blood donation center was closed. And similar fogging was conducted in all the blood donation vehicles, whether it was the Blood Mobile or it was the transport vehicles, and all the frequently touched surfaces were disinfected. And temperature scanning was instituted, provision of masks for people who did not have, and hand sanitation facility was instituted. Then donor screening, the new deferral was put into place. The mechanisms or the guidelines issued by NBTC were incorporated into our working. And then we started working with our staff slowly, and the biomedical waste was managed as per the local guidelines of the institute. So this was the first document which we prepared for our camp organizers, and we passed on to them using all media. And it was requested that it is the collective responsibility of the society and the blood transfusion services to jointly face this challenge bravely in order to ensure availability of adequate blood stocks so that we support the patient needs. And they were asked to stagger donors, avoid clustering, and they were asked to reach out to their donors through messages that those having any of the symptoms that could predispose or would point towards COVID, or have persons in their family having such symptoms, that they should self-exclude and not come to the location of the blood donation centers. And the other guidelines like no handshakes, cuff etiquette, and hand hygiene, masks, all were put in place. So we prepared this small video clip. This was very important in building the confidence of donors as well as the organizers. When they could see this clip, would detail all activities that we were taking, the frequent cleaning, the fogging, and how our blood donation center is separate from the COVID hospital. That means you are not exposed to hospital environment. We detailed our vehicle traveling from the gate to the transfusion blood donation center and showed them the practices instituted at the blood donation center. And once people could see this, were they more convinced to come back to us? And then we did all that the previous speaker told about in terms of managing the blood donations. This was another release from the ministry, which was very helpful since it facilitated clear unhindered movement of vehicles throughout the state, because Union Territory of Chandigarh itself is not enough to give us the blood required by PGI. We had to go into Haryana and Punjab, and these letters were very helpful. This is how we spread our camp. The layout was spread over the temperature scanning and hygiene. And this is how we got rid of all the cloth material that was being used, and we started sanitizing the leather material, resin material, with the disinfectant after each donor. so that we could build confidence of the donors. This is how the spacing was done. And the previous speaker could mention that we seek support from religious organizations and other organizations. This is that vehicle, and this is the 14 June celebration. This vehicle was of fantastic utility in terms of camps. And these were the guidances from the National Blood Transfusion Council. And we incorporated each one of them. There was guidance on issuance of donor appointment letters. And there was about free movement of the blood mobiles. There was a very clear and nice the information provided to the donor that in case you develop any symptoms, please do report back to the blood bank on the donor thank you card. There is the blood donation center's number, and there is a mobile number to facilitate such bi-directional information, and all other mechanisms were put into place. So this is how we started the year in 2019. You can see there were 29 blood donation camps in January, and we started with a bang. We did 40 outdoor blood donation camps. However, surely by February, we were down 3%. In March, we were down 20% in terms of camps. And here comes April, and you see we were unable to do many camps, and we did only 11. So we were down by 70%. Then we had our ups and downs. The month of June was very strong, and we could come back with a bang. And sooner or later, we closed the year with 410 outdoor voluntary blood donation camps, vis-a-vis 414 in the year 2019. So we intensified our efforts because the collection was smaller at each camp. So when you compare collection across the 2 years, you will see that January and February, we were ahead of our usual collection, and then comes the big COVID. What it did, we were all in red, and finally we managed to collect 44,000, close to 45,000 blood units, in contrast to 58,000 collection in the year 2019. So there was a shortfall of 22 or 23%. Now we also did a knowledge attitude online survey to find out what is going around and how we should go about. So we sent, prepared a questionnaire, sent it through WhatsApp and email to around 1,000 donors, and 749 donors amongst those who mentioned that we did not donate this period. They were open to give reasons for not donation, and this is what the scene was like. So around 415 out of 745 did not mention any fear for not donating blood. So this is one pool which can always be utilized. And no, it is the other way, sorry. 415 mentioned fears, whereas 334 did not mention any fear. So this is the green color is given for that tappable pool. And these were the fears in those people. So somebody said he could tick 3 fears, somebody could tick 4 fears. Surprisingly enough, there was no one who mentioned a single fear inhibiting blood donations, and these were the common. So they were concerned about the safety measures at hospitals, the majority, 55%, and there was a fear of transmitting infection to their family, whereas the primary fear of having COVID, contracting COVID, was slightly less. And there were other fears like weakening of immunity, fear of general hospital entry, and fear of entry into a COVID designated hospital, and family restrictions, or a fear to move out of home, fear of police or breaking norms of lockdown. Luckily, the fear of blood wastage was not that much. So when we analyzed all this, we understood that there were a potential pool of population who did not respond to fear items, and this should be the primary target for interventions during such pandemics, though interventions may also be carried out on participants who reported fears. And these targeted interventions could utilize 5 important strategies that emerged from this study. And the primary or the main thing is to build confidence amongst the donor base with clear and dedicated communication using all modalities which are available to augment blood donation. The first strategy is to tell them about implementation and strict adherence of safety measures so that there is no infection transmission during the act of blood donation. The second is that COVID does not spread primarily by the process of blood donation, and therefore, if you follow all in guidelines, there is no fear of transmission of COVID to your family. The third is that we must focus on the eligible donor, blood donor population. The fourth is that we must consider shifting donations towards standalone blood centers, and you must use the blood mobile so that you are near to the donor, because there was a fear of traveling specifically out of the house or going into a general hospital or going into a COVID designated hospital. This, apart from pandemics, would also be a very good strategy that you have blood collection centers which are away from the hospital, just like there is a system of blood collection in the United States of America, and they collect and supply. And the fifth is the facility of dedicated sanitized vehicles and issue of travel passes for facilitation of blood donors. And the final is that all this, if it could by any chance be part of the government's commitment towards COVID, could have also had a wing towards commitment or towards blood donation, because government has a lot of machinery. So that help could have helped the blood transfusion services. And this is what took us to the TAME home messages, that pandemic situations are always a threat and challenge to mankind. There is extra burden on healthcare, including the transfusion services. There is a need for disaster management. And the overall health plan should have a specific focus on transfusion services, and there has to be regional and national level commitment. There was, in terms of the issuance of orders by the Chandigarh administration, the orders from NBTC, the free movement, bus movement from the health ministry, and you have to finally build the trust of your regular repeat donor organizations. And it is the donor satisfaction that is the key to this once they are convinced. And you have to provide IEC to sensitize the staff and train them to handle how to handle sampling, and a proactive approach of administration, as in case I have told you was of the national and the Chandigarh region, and of your hospital helps you go through this. And we acknowledge all our donor organizations, the Institute Administration, the National Blood Transfusion Council, and all cadre of our staff who helped us survive this pandemic. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you for the wonderful presentation, sir. Sir, we also have one question. Yes. Was there any comparison of percentage of utilization in the years of 2019 and 20, like the blood donations were compared?
Yes, there was a shortfall, and whatever we could bring was used. There is data to that, but offhand, I am not absolutely clear on that.
Ma'am?
Yes. So thank you very much, Dr. Sucheth, for that excellent presentation. And it shows a very meticulous approach to take care of the voluntary blood donation, to bring the donors in view of such a challenging situation. And one of my suggestions would be that you could actually write an SOP, because whatever you have learned during this pandemic, such a pandemic may not come for another decade. We don't know. Now, nobody is sure about these things. But it's very important that the lesson which you have learned, the steps which you have taken, and how you have shown that dip down to 11 camps in the month of April, and then going back to about your 35 to 40 camps by the year end. So I think each and every step needs to be documented, and it is good to have a standard operating procedure on this. And I think that question is very good. You could also look at the blood utilization, and then you could see that how the supply and demand were balanced during these months.
Yes, ma'am. That is also available offhand. I am not very like collecting, but that is prepared. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, so thank you very much. And I think we've had two excellent presentations. And, you know, we are still learning so much about this disease, not only in terms of management, in terms of prevention, in terms of the immunity, but the tremendous social challenges, the donation issues, and they have affected not only developing countries. India has done reasonably well. Some parts of India have done quite well. But even in the developed countries, there have been challenges. So that is why I think whatever lessons each one of you has learned to date should be documented very well, so that whenever such a situation arises again, one is prepared, and then one doesn't have to take so many months of preparation to get back to, you know, giving the standard of care or desired services. So with that, Dr. Usha and Dr. Srinivas, we can close the first session. And I thank you very much for inviting me to participate in this CME. And I'm so happy to see all of you. And although we are not meeting, but I think off and on when you put your videos on, it feels good. It feels connected. And all the best to you once again. Thank you very much.